and seated. So my friends in Christ, let us confess our sins to God our Father and ask him the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. We confess that we are born in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbour as ourselves. We deserve your eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. So I ask each of you in the presence of God who searches the heart, do you confess that you have sinned and do you repent of your sins? Do you believe that Jesus Christ has redeemed you from all your sins and do you desire forgiveness in his name? And do you intend with the help of the Holy Spirit to live as in God's presence and to strive daily to lead a holy life even as Christ has made you holy? My friends, as a called and ordained servant of the word, I announce the grace of God to all of you. And on behalf of my Lord Jesus Christ and by his command, I forgive the sins of all of you who repent and believe, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Amen. We sing together the hymn, And Could It Be? my shepherd, I lack nothing.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul.
He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Glory to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And we pray together. Loving God, we thank you that your Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd who cares for your people. Open our hearts to hear his voice, to know him as he calls us by name, and to follow wherever he leads. For he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May he, God, speak to us in our readings.
Our first reading this morning comes from Acts 4, verses 5 to 12. Peter and John before the council. The next day the rulers, the elders and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander and others of the high priest family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from 1 John 3, 16 to 24, the Christian's assurance. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence in before God and receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command: to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from John 10. 11 to 18. The good shepherd dies for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Together we speak our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
My friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. In this season of Easter, like all Easter seasons, we've been hearing from the book of Acts and the beginning of the church. And today we heard from Acts chapter 4, from verse 5 to verse 12. And this reading, it comes after the event of God healing a man who was born lame from birth. And God does this through Peter and John. And this happens around the temple. And then all the people, witnesses, come rushing and they want to see what's going on. They want to hear why Peter and John have done this. So just skip back to the first verse of chapter 4. And this is what happens in response to Peter and John preaching and after the healing. It says, the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. So this was an exciting time, but problems were just over the horizon because the church had come to the attention of the very people who tried to stamp out the whole movement when they crucified Jesus. Now you would expect that with the healing of a man who had been lame from birth, the whole city of Jerusalem would be rejoicing. It was a clear sign that God was near. People should have been overwhelmed with joy. But while Peter was speaking to the crowd that were drawn to the temple gates after this healing, Luke tells us that the religious leaders of the temple, along with the captain of the temple police, they were greatly disturbed by what was going on. The religious leaders, see, they had been collaborating with the Roman occupying government, which allowed them to keep their wealth and power, so that they were in partnership. And their job, the religious leaders, their job was to maintain the peace of Rome, the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, in Jerusalem. So it worked for everyone involved, except the people who were suffering under that tyrannical rule. So the Church of Jesus Christ, it was a threat to the peace of the city and the power of these religious leaders. Therefore, it had to be stopped. And so Peter and John, they were arrested and spent the night in jail while the leaders figured out what to do. And then when the sun rose in the morning, we heard in our reading, it said that the next day the rulers, elders and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. And Annas, the high priest, was there. And so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and the other men of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, by what power or what name did you do this, healing that man? And so the Sanhedrin, the ruling council in Jerusalem, had convened in an emergency session. The high priest has virtually brought his whole family. Something big is about to happen. See, they know that their power, the ruling council, their power rests in the Roman legions just outside the city gates. Their authority is in the name of Caesar, the Roman emperor. So they've asked Peter and John, a couple of illiterate Galilean fishermen, for the source of their power and their authority to disrupt the peace of the city, as they had done with the miracle and their preaching about the resurrection. And then Peter answers them, and he says from verse 8 to 11, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man, this lame man, stands before you healed. He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone, talking about Jesus. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men, given to all people, by which we must be saved. So Peter is saying that the source of the church's power is the Holy Spirit. And the church derives its authority from Jesus Christ, who God raised from the dead. And today, some 2,000 odd years later, we still act under this authority and with this power. It's interesting that just a few months or so before this event, the Apostle Peter, he was fearing the power and authority of Rome. And in that fear, he denied that he knew Jesus. But now, empowered by the Holy Spirit, Peter has changed. He's repented, changing from fear to boldness. He's still subject to the power of the Roman legions and the authority of the emperor. But now he no longer fears them because he knows of the greater power of the Holy Spirit and the ultimate authority of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I said that Peter realizes that the only thing the Roman Empire could do to him was put him to death. They could crucify him just as they had crucified his Lord Jesus. But if resurrection is true, then death is no longer something to fear. And if people no longer fear death, then the threat of death no longer intimidates them. And see, the Jewish leaders thought they could intimidate Peter and John with the threat of death. But this threat no longer worked. What if we acted as if it didn't matter if we lived or died? What if we could no longer be intimidated with the threat of death? What could we boldly do if we no longer feared anything? I think a community would be transformed. And this is exactly what happened to those 5,000 people who joined the church in those weeks after the resurrection. As we hear through Acts, at the beginning of Acts, they were of one mind and shared what they had. They feared nothing and they boldly followed Jesus Christ as Lord. And so Luke tells us that the religious leaders, they were astonished by what Peter told them. They remembered that these were the unschooled fishermen who had come to town with Jesus. But the leaders didn't know what to do. And they didn't know how to handle the lame man who had been healed. So they decided to say nothing and asked Peter and John to leave the room while they deliberated. They decided to tell Peter to stop proclaiming the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and teaching that the Hebrew Scriptures had predicted all of this. And Peter's response, this was extraordinary. He told them that he had been called by God to make this proclamation. And he asked them a simple question. Should he obey God with the power of the Holy Spirit under the authority of Jesus Christ? Or should he obey them, who only have the power of the Roman legions and operated under the power, or under the authority rather, of the emperor? And so this question Peter posed to the religious authorities was whether we are all to follow God or something else. And the religious leaders, they couldn't answer this. They knew that they had to follow Rome for their own protection. But they saw the miracle of a man who had been lame for 40 years, now walking. They saw the excitement that was building in the city. But they didn't know what to do. So they made some empty threats and released the apostles. So Peter and John went back to the church and told the people what happened. They decided to gather together in prayer. And this is how they prayed. And this is in verse 24 of chapter 4. I said, Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth, the sea and everything in them, it is you who said by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples imagine vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers have gathered together against the Lord and against his Messiah. For in this city, in fact, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look at their threats and grant your servants to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And it's with this prayer that the whole church was filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and began to boldly proclaim the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead with the promise of eternal life. And so it's my prayer that our church would be filled with boldness too, that our fears would be washed away, and that we would boldly proclaim Jesus Christ through our words, through our actions, that we too can be witnesses to the great things that Jesus has done within our families, within our communities, with those whom we gather with. Because our power comes from the Holy Spirit, who is able to do miraculous things. And our authority, the right that we have, is in Jesus Christ. So my friends, as you go from here, may the light of Christ shine brightly through you. And may you live full with the fullness of the Holy Spirit's power as you proclaim Jesus Christ risen through your words, through your actions. And so may the peace of God, which passes our understanding, may it guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We're going to sing our next hymn, Saviour, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us.
Thank you.
stand, if you're able, as we speak together the offertory. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. And let me see it for our prayers. Let's pray. As sheep trust their shepherd for guidance and protection, let us turn to our God in prayer, certain that he hears our voice for the sake of Jesus Christ, his Son. Heavenly Father, we pray for all pastors as they shepherd the flock of Christ. We especially pray for our Bishop, John Henderson, and our District Bishop, David Altus. In all their difficult tasks, we pray that you would give them strength, wisdom, and guidance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Care for all who are called to lay down their lives and are suffering for their faith. Give them the strength and the faith to endure their hardships and bring people to faith through their witness. Give to us the faith to stand firm against oppression and persecution, and help us to give a strong testimony of our faith at all times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all rulers and governments around the world. Help them to be faithful shepherds to their people. Make them favourable to your word, so that people everywhere may be able to worship you freely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have become lost on the path of life. Bring them back to your fold. Help us all to care for our lost brothers and sisters, and to help where we can to remind them of your constant goodness and kindness. We pray for your protection over the families of our congregation and for all young people who are going instruction in the faith. Open their hearts and their minds to hear your voice and to follow you on the right paths. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, watch over the dying and those who mourn. Walk with them through the valley of the shadow of death and bring them safely to your pasture. Comfort those who mourn with the hope that we have in you, and that we'll be raised again in the final resurrection from the dead, and that with you we may feast in your house forever. Lord, we bring before you those within our community and on our hearts whom we know to be in need. Lord, we lift up to you Judith Nitschke and the family as they mourn the death of Hartley. Lord, we bring before you those who are unwell and recovering from an operation, in particular Neil Crucial, Marlene Bennett, Scott Gillett, Glenys Albright. And hear us now, Lord God, as we name those who you've placed in our hearts, as we speak them in the quiet of our hearts to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks for all who serve and have served in our armed forces. This Anzac Day, we pray for those suffering from the effects of war, mental and physical. We pray for those with friends and relatives in current theatres of war, for those mourning people who died in war, and for the carers of returned servicemen and women. Lord, guide those in authority so that they may engage in war only for the sake of peace. Lord God, we pray that we may love our enemies just as you love the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Shepherd God, you gather your sheep from all corners of the world and do not allow even one of your flock to be lost. May we and all people hear your voice and be gathered into the one flock of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favour and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please remain standing if you're able as we sing our closing hymn. Please join us outside for a cuppa.